In this session of numerical methods, I like to add a small discussion to the time discretization of stochastic processes. So we had this larger chapter on the time discretization of stochastic processes. And well, the prominent example is the Euler scheme. And yeah, we already observed that we can get quite far with the Euler scheme if we combine it with the with Itô's lemma. So if we transform the variable to a different space, then this is really a good scheme. Yeah, so simple, but sufficient in many cases. Okay, and the starting point is, of course, a time discretization. So we have here the time discretization Ti. And then we discretize the process, so the time continuous process becomes a time discrete process by using here our Brownian increments over this time step. And yeah, then we already had maybe a discussion on the time discretization. So the time discretization should be chosen such that it suits your application. So for example, if your financial product has option maturities at certain times, yeah, so then it's maybe wise to choose these times as part of your time discretization. Maybe you should not choose the time discretization finer if you do not need the finer time points. Well, that depends on the problem. Do you have a time discretization error in your numerical scheme? Then if you choose more time points, the time discretization error of the numerical scheme will be reduced. But if you use more time points, you need to generate more random numbers here. And actually this delta, the sequence of delta W's can be interpreted as a random vector. I will make a comment on this later. And then the random number generator is in a higher dimension. And this may also degrade the quality of the random number generator, and then the quality of the approximation. So in terms of Monte Carlo error. So choosing more time points will reduce the time discretization error if you have a time discretization error, but it may increase the Monte Carlo error by degrading the quality of the random number generator. If we have an Euler scheme that is exact, for example, like in Black-Scholes model, we move to log coordinates and we know that Euler scheme is then in log coordinates the exact solution, then we should choose as few time points as possible. So the points are there where we need them, but we do not choose more. But it may happen that for a certain financial product, you suddenly need more time points. So I discussed the separation of the model and the product. So the model provides the quantities X in the previous slide, and the financial product then uses these quantities. And it may happen that you have a financial product where you suddenly require more points than generated by the simulation. So we have a question here. Given an Euler scheme that already created a time discrete process from a time continuous process, can we refine, so later, the time discretization? And in the first step, let's ask this question just on the Brownian motion. So given a Brownian motion, can we refine, so create a finer discretization that is somehow embedded in a coarser time discretization? So this is then the Brownian bridge. So we are bridging two sample times within a Brownian motion, such that the result is a finer Brownian motion. So given here our time discretization T0 to Tn, the rule to generate a Brownian motion is given here. We start from some value at t0. So if t0 is the initial value, then w of t0 is 0 by the definition of the point in motion. And then in each time step, we have an independent increment, which is constructed here from a standard normal random variable, which has mean 0, variance 1, and the increment of the point in motion has mean 0 and variance time step size. So tj plus 1 minus tj. So this guy here is then the standard deviation of the Brownian increment. And then this is the increment. We just take the sum and then we generate w at ti from a previous value. We're just by summing up this increment. So assume you arrived here at, say, this time point here. Say this is some tk, yeah. And then the next time point is a normal distribution, yeah, sampled here. So we sample different values at the time point tk plus 1. Okay, so for different omegas, so the equation on top is written in terms of random variables, so holds for each omega. And we jump from here to here. And so the question is now, if I would like to refine this Brownian motion, so this means I have here now a finer time discretization within, how can I generate the samples in between these two given points? So we have a starting point here, and I have the condition that I would like to end here. And somehow, in between, there should be a sample path such that the whole path in the end is actually a Brownian motion. So it should have some drift, because I see that the mean of the increment cannot be zero. I mean, it has to have some upward slope, and this drift is given by the difference of the starting point and the endpoint, so endpoint minus starting point. And it should, of course, also have some variance. But how does the variance behave? So it cannot be that the variance is just small here in the starting point, and then it's large at the endpoint, okay, because that doesn't make sense. Yeah. Okay, so it has to shrink at the endpoint. So you see, maybe it's not so easy to construct this guy. It's not so obvious, maybe. And then, of course, the whole situation is stochastic. On another pass, the endpoint may be just different. Okay, so here I have a downward slope. Okay, so to answer this question, I need to understand the distribution between these two points. So without loss of generality, you can assume that the starting point is a zero, because if you move to a different starting point, it's just a vertical shift. But the endpoint, yeah, is a different value. So I somehow need the distribution conditional that I reach a certain endpoint. Okay, and this is answered here by the following lemma. So let W denote a Brownian motion. So I assume I already have a Brownian motion. Then what is the distribution for an in-between point? So S is an in-between point. And so without loss of generality, I assume that the starting point is in T0, is zero. So that's okay. And the endpoint is in little t. And now I have an in-between point. And I would like to know what is the distribution of WS under the condition that W of little t, so at the endpoint, I reach a given point, so a certain point. So this here is the condition. Condition that we end in y at time little t. So let's draw a picture again. So I have little t here, zero here. I start in zero and I now ask, so what is the distribution at time s? Under the condition that in time little t, I reach here the value y. Okay, and the answer, so this is a lemma which we prove, yeah, or yeah, I have a sketch of proof in the script. So the lemma gives the answer. So what do we see? So we start in zero, we end in y. So this part here is just the line connecting zero and y. So this is just like a drift. And then on top comes a normal distributed random variable. So I have here a standard normal. Okay, where the variance is, well, it looks like a quadratic function in S. Okay, so it's t minus s times s. So it's small if I'm close to zero with the s, because then this guy here is zero. And it's small if I'm close to little t, because then this guy here is zero. So somehow the variance goes a little bit up and then it goes down. Okay, so and the standard deviation is then the square root of that. And this guy below here is just a scaling. Okay, so we have some distribution here around this point, yeah, which is normal. And the path in the end then looks like that, maybe, yeah. So it goes maybe. And this gives me here actually a stochastic process as a function of little s, with a fixed s, it's a random variable. So actually it gives me multiple such paths. Okay, so that wiggle around here. So they somehow are bound to the end. And this is a Brownian motion. So this is a property of the Brownian motion. So yeah, so you see, so I started here the lemma with let W denote the Brownian motion. So this is a property of the Brownian motion. The other way around, if I would like to create an in-between sample, yeah, I know I have to sample this random variable. Okay, so let's prove it and then we can implement it or have a look at the implementation and look how it looks like. And yeah, this is helpful if you need to a posteriori refine your time discretization. So the proof is quite straightforward. If you know, for example, at the first step, that the density of this conditional random variable, so given a random variable x and y, the density of x conditional that y has a given value can be, so the density here of this guy can be expressed by the density of the random vector xy. So this here is the density of the random vector xy divided by the density of y. So divided by the density of y. So the situation which we have here is that x is our in-between sample point. So x is w of s. And y is the endpoint for which we impose the condition. So that's our situation. And the density of xy is actually a density of a random vector, yeah, where each component has a normal distribution, but there is a certain correlation between these two, yeah, because if we already reached W of S, then there is some, yeah, this has some impact on where we will end in W of T. We have this little result here, yeah, that we can express the density of this conditional random variable by these two. And our observation is that X and Y, so just maybe I repeat this here, X is W of S, Y is W of T. So both are normal distributed random variables. So if X and Y are normal with mean mu X, mu Y, and covariance matrix, sigma X, sigma XY, sigma YX, sigma Y. So this here is the covariance matrix. So sigma X is the variance of X. So variance of X is just S in our case. Sigma Y is the variance of Y. This is just T. Sigma XY is the covariance of X and Y. Okay, so what's that? And this guy is just symmetric, so it's the other way around. If you have this, you can now straightforward calculate from the previous expression by plugging in just the density functions, e to the minus x squared half and so on, that the distribution of our conditional random variable is also a normal one with a mean. So this here is the mean that is given by mu x plus sigma xy, so the covariance divided by sigma y, so divided by the variance of y, times y minus mu y. Okay, so you can just check this, yeah, straightforward calculation. And the variance is given by this expression here, sigma x minus sigma xy, sigma y inverse. So if it is a matrix there, yeah, then it's here the inverse of the matrix, otherwise it's one divided by, in our case, just one divided by sigma y times sigma y x. Okay, so you can just calculate that. So now we just need to calculate here the variance of our random variables. So variance of the Brownian motion at time s is s. Variance of the Brownian motions at time t is t. So, and what is the covariance of x and y? So ws, w of t. Okay, that's a bilinear form. Yeah, so that's actually the covariance of W of S, and then W of T is, so S is the in-between point, so it's W of S plus the increment, okay? So plus W of T minus W of S. Okay, and now covariance is a bilinear form, so this means that we have covariance of W of S with W of S, so this is here the first part. This guy, so this is just the variance of W of S. And the second part is the covariance W of S with the increment, but the increment is independent. Yeah, we have independent increments. So this guy is zero. So I have that the covariance is also just S. Okay, so we have calculated all the guys. So what do we get? Yeah, so I have here 0, 0. So I have here a y. So, and in front of the y, I have here this guy. So this is just covariance is S divided by t. Okay, so that's the guy in the lemma. S divided by t times y. And in the same way, we get here the expression for the variance. So I have here an S minus, and then I have here an S squared divided by T. Okay, so that's just S times T minus S divided by T. Okay, so we get our little result. Okay, so now we know the in-between distribution. So I know how to sample an in-between point. Okay, so just generate a normal distributed random number, you know, and scale with the standard deviation expression here, and then apply a drift. Of course, now if you have a refinement of the time discretization, so as I have drawn here in this picture, I can now do this iteratively. So I do this on the first time discretization slice. So I have a very small s here. So this is the s and a very large t minus s. And then I continue starting from that point here to go to the next point with, again, a very small s and a smaller t minus s. So, and I can create these guys here in between. So I can use now this result here to, say, reformulate the lemma a little bit more general. So I have given here a coarse time discretization from t0 to tn, which I would like to refine. So I would like to refine this here. I have a refined time discretization, which refines in between ti and ti plus one with points tij. Okay, and then the next value, so I have something which looks a little bit like an Euler scheme. Yeah. So the next value, tij, is given by starting from tij minus one. So this is the starting point. So I know now the increment starts in zero. Huh? So the remainder is like adding it to the motion which starts in zero. And what do we add? We add a drift term, which is related to our endpoint. So this part here is the drift. This is the condition that we would like to end in ti plus one, in ti plus one. And then I add this normal distributed random variable zij. So these are iid normals, scaled with this expression here. Okay, and this here is my time step from tij minus one to tij. So this is the little s, and this here is the t minus s. And this here is the t. Okay, so you have now a rule how to generate the in-between Brownian motions. You can now rearrange this a little bit. Yeah, you see you have here, this is just like the starting point. Then you see this looks like a linear interpolation of the starting and the endpoint plus a random sample. Yeah, and it, you may check which version of the formulation suits you more. Alternative version is here. Yeah, if you introduce a parameter alpha, you see that this is here this linear interpolation, and then it is a Brownian increment, so from a finer Brownian motion scaled with this one minus alpha. Yeah, so which is the condition that we are shrinking at the endpoint. So that was the Brownian bridge. You may consider different ways of implementing this. like on the slides, just going in small steps forward, or you can also have a refinement scheme, cutting into half, yeah, sample the middle point, and then refine again, cut the intervals again into half and sample the middle point. So this depends a little bit on the application, how you use the refinement, but now you have the formula. Let's maybe look at an implementation. So in the library, I already have a Brownian bridge, so maybe we can just have a look at it. So here we have a Brownian motion. This is just the interface, and then we have several implementations. So this here is the one which uses Mersenne Twister. So we just sample uniform distributed random numbers. We scale with square root of time step, and we use the inversion of the distribution function. And there is a Brownian bridge here, which is doing exactly what we had on the slide. So it samples in between points. So what do you provide? You provide the start point and the end point. Yeah. So this here is general. It doesn't start in zero or doesn't need to start in zero. You provide the start and the end point. And of course, the start and the end point are random variables. In case you have a multi-factor one, it is a vector of random variables. Yeah. So, but just consider now the number of factors one. So it's a one-dimensional Brownian motion. Then this guy is just a single random variable, the starting sample random variable and the end sample random variable. And in between, I like to use now this time discretization and these number of passes. Yeah, and here it's immediately implemented using Mersenne Twister, so a random number seed, to connect these two guys. And if you now scroll down here, yeah, the code is not so complicated. You see it's more or less exactly the formula which we had on the slides. It's the version with the notation 1 minus alpha and alpha. So this here is the linear interpolation of the starting and end point. So you see the end point here, but where's the starting point? Well, since we go time step by time step, the starting point for the next time step is the previous result. Yeah, so it is always the previous bridging point that is the starting point. So the previous bridging point multiplied with 1 minus alpha plus the end point multiplied with alpha. And then we use a Brownian increment from a finer Brownian motion, the one that samples in between, scaled with this one square root of 1 minus alpha. Let's have a look. So I have different experiments here that do some plots. Maybe just to recall, this here is an experiment you can also run maybe at home or modify a little bit that plots a Brownian motion. Okay, so this is here sample paths of a Brownian motion. So this is a very fine time discretization. But if you zoom in here, you will see that there is just a straight line between the two points. Yeah. So this is on a time discretization. So now let's have a look at a Brownian bridge. So this here is now a plot of a Brownian bridge. I sample from a Brownian motion with two time steps. I sample a starting point and an end point. So the starting point is W of T1. The end point is W of T2. I sample these two. And then in between, I'm doing a Brownian bridge with that many time steps. And let's for a second just use one time step. So actually it's not a bridge at all. And then the picture looks like that. Okay, so you see this here is the sample vector of the starting point. This here is the sample vector of the endpoint. Some points actually end here by chance at the same endpoint. Okay, mean is zero, so it could happen. Yeah, and some points move up, some points move down. Okay, so let's refine this a little bit. So if he use here two, he will just refine it. And he will add in the middle a sample point. Yes? And of course, this sample point here will be sampled around here the slope, where the slope cuts this center time here. Okay, so this is now the first refinement. And we can, of course, also have more refinements. So if we use 100 points here, then it looks like this. Okay, so you see this is a refinement, and the condition that we end in the same points in the prescribed endpoints, yeah, is fulfilled. Yeah, so you see here the endpoints in all three graphs are the same. You can also create a small animation here, yeah, if you like. So what I did here is doing this experiment with many different values for in between time points for refinement time discretization steps. So this here is the first one. This is the second one, yeah, where we refine here and refine there. And if you let this run, yeah, you see that he is creating more and more in between points. Actually, if you look at this movie, yeah, there is a certain pattern, yeah. So you see that the red line is actually just the same sample path, just squeezed to the right. Huh? So it is squeezed to the right. Okay, so like that. So it's the same sample path squeezed, and then added more points. So we are filling points to the right, but the others, they wiggle a little bit more. So why is that? So the reason is that actually there's only one long guy here for the time step. Yeah. So for this time step here, so assume I have 10 steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever. So this line here is a 10 dimensional random point. So we sample 10 random numbers and we fill this vector. And then we sample the next one. Yeah? So this guy here is 11 to 20. Okay. And the next one is then 30 to 31. So, but I have a long sequence of random numbers. And if I make this guy longer, yeah, so I use number 21 for this guy here, then actually I'm removing the first random number from this guy. Yeah? And so that's the reason why the other guys somehow look like they are shifted through a window. So if you look here, you see that if you look now, the green one here, yeah, so this mountain here, so it's just shifted like through a window. Okay, and then it becomes part of another Brownian bridge here, okay? So it's, there's some pattern. Okay, so that's the Brownian bridge. In this case, I create the Brownian bridge from a single sequence, one-dimensional sequence of random numbers, and that's why I have this pattern in the animation. Okay, so that was it for this session.